Today on Twin Cam, we're going to be talking about E10 petrol, what that means, its advantages and disadvantages, and then what it means for you and your classic car. I've been meaning to make this video for a fair few weeks now, and I was actually planning on releasing it just as E10 became available in the UK on the 1st of September. But circumstances have meant that I'm only doing it now. So sorry for it being a bit late, but I thought it was still worth making the video because there are still lots of people talking about E10 in a doom-mongering manner and talking about how it's going to destroy classic cars. But that really isn't quite the case, but we'll get to that later. But in this video overall, we're going to talk about the advantages and disadvantages when it comes to increasing the ethanol content in petrol. So first of all, what does E10 mean? Well, petrol classification in the UK is a product of history, and it's a little bit messier than it really needs to be. On most pumps, there are two grades of petrol, premium unleaded and super unleaded, or something along those lines. And I think it's worth explaining this, not just because of the differences with E10, but because quite a lot of my viewers are not from the UK. So in putting this in a UK context, it's worth explaining just how we get our fuel in the UK. The unleaded part we can ignore immediately, as UK petrol has been lead free for decades. But premium is, confusingly, the standard cheaper grade of petrol available at an octane rating of 95. Super or supreme is the more expensive petrol, and that can vary between 97 and 99 octane, depending on where you go. These octane numbers don't particularly matter to us in this context, but up until September, both these grades would have had a little symbol above, showing they were E5, meaning the oil companies were permitted to make 5% of this ethanol. Now though, the ethanol content has gone up to 10%, or E10 in premium unleaded. Super unleaded is remaining at E5 for now as a protection grade, as there are many cars that shouldn't be filled with a higher concentration of ethanol. Because this increase has a number of possible effects on you, your car, the economy, and the environment. The first thing we need to understand is what difference ethanol makes to the petrol itself. By adding ethanol, you change the chemical makeup of the fuel, and therefore the way it burns. Pure ethanol contains about a third less energy than pure petrol does, meaning that it's less efficient and that cars must run richer in order to retain the same power output. In simple terms, you have to burn more of it, and that will increase your fuel usage. But there are some significant performance advantages to using ethanol, despite having to burn a bit more of it. Ethanol is much more resistant to detonation, allowing cars to use higher compression ratios and more advanced ignition timing. This means more power. And that's why racing series all over the world swear by ethanol. When pure performance is the be-all and end-all, ethanol is just better. That's not just why it's used in racing cars, but also in modified cars where it's available. But what does this change actually mean for motorists? Well, according to the government, all cars built after 2011 are compatible with E10. But that's rubbish. A number of MG dealers have come out and said that they don't recommend the use of E10 in their cars up to 2015. Meaning that a six-year-old car apparently cannot use the fuel the government is mandating. Additionally, the government's compatibility checker is patchy. Many of the statements given to the government by manufacturers are vague. For example, Peugeot say that all their petrol cars built after the 1st of January 2000 are compatible with E10 fuel. What changed on the 1st of January 2000? They didn't introduce any new models on New Year's Day, so where's the line? Tell us which models, built when, are and aren't compatible. It surely can't be that difficult. And as a result, non-car people are none the wiser. Those with a 1998 Peugeot of some kind will be rocking about thinking that they need to pay about 10p a litre more for fuel now, and that's just not the case. Similarly, the page for Rover simply states that the company does not exist anymore. As a result, there's no information available, and Rover drivers should use E5 and pay about 10p a litre more. Now, I understand why the page says this, but the government owes it to the people they represent to provide the information on an issue that they've caused. If we look at the Land Rover page, we see that all models built since 1996 are E10 friendly, meaning by extension that a good 90% of Rovers built since that time must also be compatible. As being part of the same company at the time, they used very similar fuel systems and many of the same engines. In fact, some individuals that worked at Rover's powertrain division have confirmed that late Rovers are absolutely fine on E10. But as far as the wider public are concerned, Rovers can't run on E10. This perceived fact is being picked up by many so-called journalists who are writing doom-mongering articles based on information that's just plain incorrect. Another general problem with the switch are those who run an older car for financial reasons. There are thousands of people driving around in cars 15 to 20 years old who do so because they have to. And if their cars can't run an E10, then they're being forced to fork out over £100 a year extra on average for a higher grade of fuel. And that makes a big difference to those who are living week to week. As these cars make up the majority of those who will be most affected by E10, the argument can be made that it's essentially a tax on the poor. A final general issue is E5 availability. For those who own cars that aren't E10 compatible, they should be filling up with E5, but super unleaded isn't available at many fuel stations around the country, and in more rural areas, the vast majority of petrol stations only stock lower octane fuel, now mandated to be E10. So some people have to fill with E10, even if it could be having some negative effects on their vehicles. But the main reason for the increase in ethanol content is the positive environmental impact. It's upon this issue that 95% of the arguments for the use of ethanol come from, and as such, it's vital that this is a genuine, worthwhile positive impact. According to government figures, the switch from E5 to E10 could reduce the UK's carbon dioxide emissions by 750,000 tonnes a year, the equivalent of taking 350,000 cars off the road. And immediately, that sounds like a worthwhile change. Anything that can reduce our carbon footprint is a good thing, especially as that's compounded by better, more efficient public transport links and more people being able to work from home. The main point for ethanol is that it's a biofuel, something that can be grown and therefore it's renewable, covering one of the long-term questions over petrol availability. But there's always a cost. Growing crops to ferment into ethanol takes up space, lots of space. The largest corn producer in the world is the United States, and about 40% of all the corn they grow goes into the production of ethanol. And in a country like the US with lots of empty, fertile land, that's acceptable. But there's an issue here for smaller countries or those with terrain less friendly to farming. In those cases, where's the line between fuel production and food production? In fact, the US has had E10 for a number of years, and already 8.8% of US farmland is dedicated to the production of ethanol. 8.8% of farmland for 10% of petrol. What that encourages is higher corn prices, and therefore two things: higher food prices and more natural land being converted to farmland. So as ethanol becomes a necessity in petrol, the strain on the farming industry will only increase, but with that we see some more pressing impacts. The whole point of using ethanol is that it's more environmentally friendly in one way or another. But when it comes to pure energy, that argument begins to fall flat. A study by David Pimentel shows that production from the seed to 1 litre of pure ethanol consumes about 6,600 kilocalories. That litre only contains 5,100 kilocalories. This process is energy negative, and when we bear in mind that in order to live, we have to eat, it suddenly starts to become very questionable why we're putting all this effort and land into producing something we can, at least at the moment, get from the ground. There are some alternatives to corn though. South America is the continent that uses the most ethanol in its petrol, and they use sugarcane to produce it, which is energy positive. But again, we come back to farmland. In that chase to produce more and more ethanol, the rainforest is being destroyed. We cannot get around that one fundamental of using farming to produce fuels. In addition, the destruction of habitats isn't just harmful to wildlife, but to us as well. Just looking at emissions, the effects of the loss of forested areas will take 20 years to be recouped by the reduction in vehicle emissions, and surely by that point, vehicles should be moving away from fossil fuels anyway. The strategy from governments, therefore, seems a bit dead-ended. What's a better point for biofuels than long-term availability, though, is sustainability. As our engines burn fuel, they produce gases that are harmful towards human beings, like carbon dioxide. Potentially the biggest advantage for biofuels, therefore, is that they address this imbalance. As we all know, plants absorb carbon dioxide, potentially allowing us, in the long term, to offset one of the biggest disadvantages of burning fuel. Put that alongside the cleaner burning of ethanol, and there is a carbon-based case for using ethanol in our fuel. But when you combine it with the reality of farming and our basic human needs, and what the future looks like as well, and it begins to look decidedly patchy. So now we've discussed E10's impact on the average consumer and on the environment, we can discuss what we're all really here for, the mechanical impact on our beloved cars. When it comes to people worrying about E10 potentially causing the entire classic car world to come crashing down, it's actually something that we've seen before here in the UK. When leaded fuel was phased out about 30 years ago, people went around screaming about how it was going to destroy engines and fuel systems, especially the valve seats in cylinder heads. But time has shown that the worries were all a little bit over the top. Sure, ethanol is a different issue with different potential issues, but the UK is rather behind when it comes to this. There are whole continents that run on much more ethanol than E10. And to give just a few major examples, the United States, Australia, and the majority of the European Union all already have at least E10. In fact, the introduction of renewable fuels has been on the minds of scientists and governments for decades. If we go all the way back to 1981, 40 years ago, we can see a study on the mechanical impacts of ethanol fuels. The US Department of Energy sponsored a study that tested a number of identical engines with a range of different fuels. But the ones that we're interested here are straight petrol, E0, E10, and pure ethanol, E100. And through this, we can see the full range of ethanol's effects. The engines were run at high revs and, more importantly, high loads for 20 hours. Then the engines were disassembled and studied. They found that the difference in wear within the engine, on pistons and valves for example, is negligible. But they found that the oil in engines running ethanol contained ever so slightly less metal. But again, very small differences. What they also found was that E100 has a significant cleansing effect when it comes to avoiding sludge buildup, something that a lot of expensive fuels promise to do. But with such a small amount of ethanol in the fuel as we're seeing with E10, that difference is minimised. Their final interesting point was that the engine oil contained trace amounts more water when running on ethanol than it did on petrol, bringing us on to a much bigger potential issue. This is the one people are worrying about, the fuel systems and fuel hoses in classic cars. If you remember back to chemistry at high school, you'll know that ethanol is a solvent, meaning it degrades certain materials such as rubber much quicker than petrol does. And this causes a massive potential safety issue. If the gaskets in your carburetor, for example, or the rubber fuel hose start to degrade and leak, that's not good news. Especially in an Austin A-series engine like the car sitting directly behind me, where the carburetor sits right above the exhaust manifold. If the carb or the fuel hoses start leaking, that's a fire waiting to happen. If you increase the ethanol content in the fuel, those materials degrade quicker and the risk of fire increases. But apart from E10, there are two distinct problems. First is that an awful lot of the rubber on sale at the moment is of appalling quality. Frankly, regulations should be made much stiffer in this field, as these are people's lives at stake. But there is fuel hose out there that even on E5 has started to crack within months. So if you are replacing fuel hoses, make sure they're of the highest quality you can possibly find. Second of all is us, people. We're inherently stupid. And as classic car enthusiasts, we're driving around in cars with rubber componentry that is potentially decades old. 99% of motorists that have just about managed to get it into their fat heads that rubber ages. We understand that tyres, even if not used, eventually get old, go hard, and crack. As a result, we change them. So why is it so difficult to get people to change their fuel hoses? After all, my little Metro should have had a couple of sets of fuel hoses by this stage, and I'm pleased to confirm that the hoses look in perfect condition, because I check them, just as you should. So please, for your own safety, check the condition of your fuel hoses. If you need new ones, go and get new ones, because it might save your life, and it might save your car. We, as a car community, need to begin to take this seriously. There will always be idiots out there that don't care about the condition of their cars, but this matters not just for your safety, but for the future of our hobby. We're living in an age where new technologies are coming in and replacing the internal combustion engine. And most governments around the world are happy to allow classic cars to exist, as they should. But if you're negligent and one day your MGB or your Volkswagen Transporter catches fire, that paints a bad picture for old cars in the heads of those who use cars merely as transport. Some incidents can't be foreseen, but don't let a lack of maintenance make us all look bad. Sorry for rambling and getting a bit off topic, but the main practical vehicle-based complaint regarding E10 is the degradation of fuel systems. And though some materials used to produce fuel tanks or tiny components in carburettors may be difficult to get up to E10 standards, just make sure that it isn't something as stupid as fuel hoses. Our conclusion, unfortunately, is that for all the positive arguments, the use of ethanol just doesn't translate into a worthy alternative. It's less efficient and it takes up a ridiculous amount of land, costing consumers more money in both fuel and in food. It has the opportunity to damage parts of your fuel system, though not as dramatically as some people fear. And its environmental credentials are questionable when we consider that within 20 years, the majority of everyday run-of-the-mill cars should be electric. In fact, the existence of the electric car makes ethanol look worse thanks to its habitat damage. And at this point, as petrol-powered cars are beginning to become legacy products, is such an upheaval even worth the political will? I'm not an expert on any of these things. In fact, I'm comparatively stupid. Everything I know has been found out through a very, very basic level of research. So if you know something I don't, or work on this for a living, please do comment down below and tell me. Because information is invaluable, and information dispels myths and untruths. But for now, there was a little overview of the main points surrounding E10 petrol. So thank you very much for watching. If you enjoyed the video, please do click like and subscribe to TwinCam as ever. I'm forever indebted to my wonderful Patreon supporters, so if you'd like to support me that way, then please do follow the link in the description. And I'll have more videos coming along soon.